Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So I just want to say thank you for allowing me to take the summer here and to do something kind of off the wall with the sermons, and that is to say preaching on songs that are not typically the songs we sing or play in church, but they are the songs that many of us listen to throughout our daily lives. And so it's been kind of fun to have so many of you offer me songs to preach on. And the whole point isn't just to be off the wall or to do something crazy or just creative, but the point is for us to be always searching for God in every facet of our lives. God is woven into the very fabric of everything that we do. And so that it's not just when we read the scriptures, it's not just when we sing our hymns here in church or listen to contemporary Christian music where we find God or can articulate what God's up to, but we should always be striving to be able to articulate what God's up to in every part of our lives, whether we're walking down the street here after church is over to our car, or going to the grocery store, or listening to the radio when all kinds of music plays. We should be able to say, that makes me think about God in this way. I mean, that's the beauty of music and poetry and art, is it encourages us to think about God in new ways, in ways that we never would have thought of before. So, again, I am very appreciative for the grace to go down this road over the summer here and try something a little different. Probably not everybody loves it, but I understand that too, and I appreciate that sentiment also, but I appreciate the latitude to do this. Today, our song is by another familiar singer in American history. Not an American, though, himself. This is actually a John Lennon tune, not the Beatles. John Lennon, Imagine. And so, Joe, give us John Lennon, Imagine. That was a multiple request song there. Let's use our imaginations a little bit this morning. Imagine to think of or create something that is not real in your mind. To imagine is to form a picture or idea in your mind of something that is not real or present. Last winter, with all the Star Wars Episode 7 hoopla, we decided that it was time to introduce Jacob to the Star Wars franchise. He's 7, so clearly of age to know about Star Wars, we figured. We had the big task in front of us of deciding how we would introduce Star Wars to him. Do you go the old traditional route and go 4, 5, 6, and then 1, 2, 3, you know, the way they came out initially back in the 70s and 80s? Or do you start in the chronology of the story? Do you start with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? Well, I mean, these are kind of big decisions you have to make in life sometimes. We decided to go from the very beginning of the story. Stories are important, so we'd start right at the beginning of the story with Episode 1. Episode 1 was good. He liked it. Jar Jar Binks was a hit in our house. Goofball that he is. A few days later, we moved on to Episode 2. Again, it was successful. A little darker. Jacob started noticing that this Anakin guy is kind of mean, kind of angry, but we continued on. Episode 3, big mistake. It had been quite a few years since Stacy and I had watched Episode 3, and we'd forgotten how intense the final scene was between Anakin as he morphs into this great Darth Vader. That transition from Anakin into Darth Vader in Episode 3 was, well, it was difficult for Jacob. This poor kid had a hard time going to bed that night, and he refused to turn his lights out. A battle we are still going down. At one point, in the middle of the night, as we were encouraging him that it was all right in the world, there's nothing to be worried about, Darth Vader isn't really real, he's not out there with his Death Star anywhere, you don't need to be worried, he says, "Why didn't you just read me the story so that I could have imagined it on my own?" Without seeing it. What an awesome and beautiful observation from my little 7-year-old. I would rather have imagined it, Daddy, than someone else making me look at it their way. I don't think I've heard people say that before, talk like that before. We don't do well with imagining things anymore. We're not people of imagination. TV and video supply us with all the creativity and imagination we need. We just turn on the TV to see someone else's creativity. When we watch Star Wars, we don't need to imagine how small Yoda is. We don't have to imagine what his wispy gray hair looks like or how green his skin is. We don't have to imagine his gravelly voice or the backwards way in which he speaks. It's all given to us. We just absorb it. We just soak it in and turn off our imaginations. And I would even say that in our culture, we almost look down upon imagination sometimes. We've spent the last couple hundred years as a society trying to explain things rather than using our imaginations. We are people of science. We're people of physics and engineering. We have scientific method now. We will explain things. We will explain why things happen, why things go the way they go. It seems to be our intent to not leave things to the imagination any longer. We want absolutes, black and white. We want explanations and reasons why things happen the way they do. Someone gets sick, we want all the medical scans to find out exactly what the cause is. After people die, we do autopsies to figure out what the cause of death was. If there's a problem, it's like we need to have the answer to the problem. To imagine is to stand apart from that way of thinking, to not deal in the concrete, to think of something that doesn't even exist. To imagine is to hope and dream and expand into new places. The song by John Lennon probably fits better into the world of the Bible than it does into our 2016 world. It almost seems like it would fit somewhere in the Psalms, or perhaps even better, it would fit into the prophets as they imagine a new world where God is in the world and active, different from their current world. The year of many thousands ago was quite comfortable speaking like this. The words that the audiences of Jesus and those of 2,000 years ago, these words, they're words that they would have been quite comfortable with. They weren't literally minded people. They weren't bound by absolutes or seeking black and white answers to things. No, the people from thousands of years ago, they were storytellers. They used metaphor and imagery to make their points or to encourage people to converse about things, to talk. They encouraged people to use their imagination. So John Lennon writes, "Imagine there's no heaven or hell." As we started with that first phrase in our Bible study for Wednesday morning, we were uncomfortable with that phrase. Imagine no heaven or hell. What's going on with John Lennon here? Is this some sort of heretical statement going on? Seems uncomfortable. But then we realized that there's this concluding statement for that first verse. Imagine all the people living for today. You see, when we faith people, and this is something we faith people do, we get all balled up in the heaven-hell conversation. And when we become heaven-hell people, we stop living for this moment. And we start living for some future moment. How many times have you heard faith people calling others to a certain way of living or a certain morality because of heaven-hell implications? Maybe we've talked like that before. How often do we hear faith people guilting other people or being motivated themselves because of heaven or hell? Do this or hell in the future. Imagine, says the poet and prophet, imagine if we just live for today. Imagine if we were just living for this moment. This isn't absolutist terms. He isn't saying this is the way it is. He's inviting us to imagine. The next verse speaks particularly powerful to us in light of the events of the last week or so here in America. Imagine there's no countries. Imagine there's no religion. Nothing to kill or die for, he says. Rather, living life in peace. Rather than literally countries or religions, how about we imagine those words as in anything that divides us. Imagine there is nothing that divides us. There's nothing that causes us to hate or look down upon the other person. Imagine that there's nothing that causes us to fear each other. Imagine that there's nothing that would make an enemy out of somebody else. In some ways, I feel like these words fit perfectly into the Jesus of 2,000 years ago. I can imagine Jesus reading these words of John Lennon and then telling a parable about them. Or maybe he does tell parables about these sorts of words. Like at one point, he tells a story. It's a made-up story. That's what the parables were. About a man who's walking down the road and he gets all beat up. Two rabbis or religious people walk along the path and they see this guy all beat up. And they walk on the other side of the road wanting nothing to do with that beat up guy, leaving him dying on the road. And then Jesus in his story tells about a former enemy of the Jews, the worst of the worst, the Samaritan. He comes down the road. He sees the man. His heart breaks. He cares for him. He bandages up his wounds. He carries him to the inn where medical care would be offered, and he pays for it all. Friends, can you imagine this past week having been down? I guess there was a little parade that happened on Wednesday downtown. Something happened. I don't know. They're celebrating something. Can you imagine being down there and getting beat up and left in an alleyway? And then you see Pastor so-and-so walk by and Father so-and-so walk by. And then a member of ISIS walks by. And he is the one who bends down and cares for you. Shocking. Unrealistic. Ridiculous. That is the sort of imagination that Jesus uses often. Imagine ancient enemy Samaritans. Or in other stories, imagine mortal enemy Syrophoenician people, a woman in Jesus' story. Imagine Roman soldiers with dying slaves or children. Imagine prostitutes, tax collectors. Imagine people of other skin colors. Imagine people of other faith traditions. Imagine people of other sexual orientation. Imagine straight people. Imagine people of other ethnicities and other cultures. A brother and sisterhood of one people, the poet John Lennon speaks of, sharing all the world. This week, friends, we saw the worst of humanity. We saw what happens when we don't use our imagination. A messed up and hateful person goes into a nightclub and shoots over 100 of God's children. People God loves and cares for dearly. Unimaginatively, some faith people respond to that evil by going and protesting the funerals of those who have died. Again, protesting the deaths of God's beautiful children. There's no imagination in any of that. Returning evil for evil is not imagination. There's no imagination in shooting those you are afraid of or those who are different from you. There's no imagination in protesting and standing apart from those who think differently from the way you think. But there is imagination in loving. There's great imagination that's needed right now. New ways of thinking and new ways of living and operating are needed right now. We need new prophets and new people of creativity. We need people of imagination to help us stand apart from the hating of each other and catch hold of this new way of living. Friends, we need dreamers.